decide to get shorter or longer. DNA is just a stupid molecule, and what happens is a response, you know, better than me, of the systemic answer. It's the whole body, the whole experience that produce a cascade of effect, and only the end effect is reflected in the shortening. DNA alone doesn't do anything, so the system. The second point, more subtle, and has about to do with the relation between suffering and mirror neurons. And maybe you can clarify this point, which I also have discussed once with Rizzolatti and Gallese, the group in Parma responsible for this discovery. Now, there is the stage that somebody gets a syringe in the hands, suffers, and some of the neuron fires. I am watching that, and the same neuron fire, but I, the observer, does not feel anything. It's not that this firing of the neuron of the observer induces emotions. There is firing without corresponding emotions. And Rizzolatti and Gallese to that say, yes, this is true, but that may indicate that maybe 1 million years ago there was some relation between neurons and emotions that we have lost with, you know. So what is your answer to that?
It's a great question. My limited understanding is that the mirror neuron system makes available information that then is used depending upon the context. So if we think about, say, Tanya Singer's fMRI experiments, where you hold the hand of a loved one while they get shocked and you're scanned, well, and they get shocked and you're getting scanned and your pain network, they show significant increase in the activation of the anterior insula and cingulate. There is a subjective report of pain. If I see my child get injured, I feel pain. The mirror neuron system it would be analogous in my simple way of thinking about it, that you have a visual stimulus of a person you know, and you record the visual activity, and you have a person you don't know, and you have similar visual activity, but the whole cascade of consequence activation to the person you know brings up this prior knowledge. So the mirror neuron system is a part of action perception that does not determine the consequent engagement in terms of in what your interpretation is. And that requires so much more of the brain and your knowledge than simply the small island of activity in the premotor cortex and the brain. Yeah. That would be how I would say it. And Rizzolatti has written about that. And Gallese, you know, there's sometimes this mutual constraint between them about what is this story. Because it's another one of these things that's gotten a lot of airplay.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, Keith. Thank you very much for this splendid talk, as ever. I take some elements of your talk as a proof that there cannot be a completely detached, objective discourse about the, you know, the experience and meaning of meditation for us. Why? Because each time you try to draw a general objective conclusion about, you know, the brain areas that are involved in this practice, then you have a sort of feedback effect on the very practice, on the way the people are conceiving their own practice. You have a sort of self-fulfilling prophecy in some way. So that if explanation about how meditation works in Ukraine goes on in the large public. The large public will conclude that meditation is only that, namely just a training for the amygdala. So can you comment on this strange loop between the objective knowledge and the subjective effect of this objective knowledge?
I think it's a kind of brainwashing.
mind-washing
about brains. I think that the public communication has been required because of, well, the simple story allows people to feel like they understand. And when you feel like you understand what you're reading, you'll keep reading. And then you'll be able to see the advertisements or whatever on the page. And as soon as you begin to feel like you don't know what you're reading, you don't know what you're understanding, then you have an aversive response. And there isn't a kind of kind meditation teacher that pops Harry Potter style out of the magazine and says, "That's fine, it's okay. You don't have to understand the sentence right now. Come back to it and read it again." See, the newspaper doesn't do that yet. But maybe there'll be a device you can buy that will tell you, you didn't understand what you just read. So this article, the dialogue that Barry Boyce and Amishi and I have in this current issue of Mindful is directly addressed to correct this kind of Lego block discussion about the most complex thing. I mean, neuroscientists don't understand how the brain works, so why should the public? It's one of these funny things. And so, because of the other piece, which is it's not real unless science says it's real, there's this reduction and this concretization of something. I love it when, Martin Van Beek says, well, we need to move from meditating to la vida contemplativa, which is a whole sense of the way to embrace life, as Brother David so beautifully put the first morning here. But that doesn't necessarily sell, devices and trainings and cassettes. Or cassettes, I mean, aging myself. Playlists for meditation and iPad.
Sorry, but I was told by the organization we have the last question, Robert.
There are telomeres in many types of human eukaryotic cells. Which cells did you measure the telomere length in?
So we measured peripheral blood monocytes. And there is, if we're going to get a little technical, we did not do flow cytometry, so that there are subtypes of monocytes, and those subtypes may have different telomere lengths themselves. So in our data, one of the limitations is that there could possibly be evidence of change in cell distributions as a function of the training. That's in the paper as a potential limitation. Next time, again, the funds and the we will look at specific subtypes of cells. But in general, there were PBMCs.
Sorry for the others, but she was before.
Another technical question, maybe I'm interested in. Which kind of biological and cellular investigation have you done? I mean, which kind of omics? So,
in collaboration with Perla Kaliman from Barcelona, we looked at gene expression in telomere-related, the telomeric interactome, and there are some significant gene expression changes that are also in the brain behavior and immunity paper that I've not gone into here. And we also looked at some epigenetic markers and pro-inflammatory cytokine markers. So we have changes in TNF alpha, gene expression in the same data. We are in a mess trying to measure a whole panel of cytokines associated with this, but we did the assays, but the BioRad assays were not reliable. We were beginning to look at oxytocin and vasopressin, but there's a whole global controversy about how do you measure them. The ENSO assays are deemed non-replicable. We had a 0.56 correlation between identical samples with identical kits in two different laboratories. So we're beginning to get into thinking about mass spec with that, but it's not our group to do that. You know, you do this, okay?
Tomorrow.
we have to talk.
We have to talk.
There was a recent meeting in Sicily about oxytocin that the global consensus is that it's a mess. Okay.
Sorry, but the time is... The organization told me to stop because we have a strong program, and we invite you to have a...